Hi everybody and welcome to another edition of the Tips and Tricks videos. My name is Dan Lopez and I am the application specialist for Tekla PowerFab. Today will be all about shipping. We'll be talking about shipping routes mainly, but also I will show you some general functionality that you may not be aware it actually exists on Tekla APM and that can be very handy for your shop. Okay, let me begin by showing you some of the standard configurations that can be adjusted on the company standard level in production control. Here we have the load tracking settings option. Let me show you my database right here. I actually preset some trailers. Like if your shop has your own equipment, you can come here and set the number of the trailers and their actual capacity. So that's preset up. When they are creating the shipping ticket, they can select those from a drop-down menu. You can make this a value required, so they never forget to actually fill that information when creating a shipping ticket. And you can also restrict this to the preset list. If that's the only equipment that you generally use for shipping, you can do something like this, or you can leave it open so they can also include some other trailers that are not in this list. I did the same for the carrier. If you have two or three companies or your own, that usually goes in there, instead of typing that every single time we're creating a shipping ticket, you have a preset list there too and make this a value required as well. Then we have in the out-of-the-box database, this is load category 1, 2, and 3. And those are usually used like this one, empty. They are not even shown when you create a shipping ticket, right? But as you can see here, I just put these two as an example. So you see how some people use this information in their shipping tickets. I create this one and say, I want to show this field and I want my guys to be putting the driver name and their cell number, right? So I always have that information in advance when I am creating the shipping ticket for them. And then I have the deliver to option here. So they also always go and put a name in there as an instruction for the driver to whom they need to deliver the material on the load. So this is kind of the idea why these fields are extra in here. I'll just go ahead and close this screen, save this. So now that's my new standard for my shipping tickets. Now, the second thing I wanna show you today is about the question that we get asked a lot in support. And is, hey, can I actually plan a load in advance or pre-create the material that needs to go into a load in particular? And the answer is yes. And it's a very simple thing to do. So to show you that, let me just open this job and go ahead and create a load super quick. And there we go. Load tracking, new load. You can see that some of the fields that we just set up are showing up in here. So I just go ahead and say this is the T01. And it's with Trimble Logistics, and this is Dan, and this is his cell number. There you go. And that's delivered to Jeff Smith. All right, so save this, add material, and this is the key for the planning on the trucks. You know, in the default database, this load on assign is actually checked. And so when you are creating a shipping ticket, you are actually moving the material and the software things that at the same time you are putting this material into the truck, right? Same EPM or EPM go. But if you actually, I just clean my screen, uncheck this box, this is not loading on the assign. It's actually just creating a preset list for this load. So I can go ahead and say, yeah, for this load, we are actually shipping at these beams right here. That's close to the capacity, so that's okay. Add material and save this, right? Even if I am not shipping this, I am just assigning material to this load. You can see the material is right here, but if I go to the loaded tab, the material is not there. So this will allow you, even if you guys are using EPM Go, let me just pull that screen and go to my shipping status. And let me refresh this screen so I can get the latest view. Job site, show on ship loads. I have my load number 1 in there and go to my material. And there you go. So this is the list that I just created a moment ago in Tekla APM. And As you can see, this is not just the whole list of material that haven't that hasn't been shipped. This is just the material that I preset for this particular load, right? So people in the yard, they can just go and say, okay, I have four of these pieces assigned into this truck. I am actually just putting right now three, load those into the truck, and that can be putting those into the truck. And you can get reports in Tekla APM about the status of each load, so you can see there what pieces have been put into the truck, which pieces haven't been put into the truck yet. So people will be following a preset list. You don't have to print a report for them about what to put into a truck anymore. You can just pre-plan your loads. All right, let me just go back to the main screen and let's talk now about shipping routes. So let me begin talking about shipping routes by giving you a brief explanation of how APM thinks about them. So in Tekla APM, the default is that we assume every single assembly is going to be shipped to the job site. So the only case where we need to do something different is for those assemblies with an intermediate destination, right? Let's call it galvanizing, rolling, bending, powder coating, or pretty much anything that requires some shipping to a secondary location. So for those cases, we have the shipping routes available, so you can always track where the assemblies are in any moment. Shipping routes can be created in a global library or in a job-by-job basis. If you need a particular, like a storage location, like you in this job, for example, if I go to the edit screen of this job, you can notice that here at the bottom right, we have the shipping routes. I can go there and I have here in this particular job an intermediate storage route for this job. Where I am saying here is, yeah, this is going actually to one of these storage locations, ABC Architects or the classroom training location, and then from there I will ship to the job site, right? So if you have limited space on your job site and you need to actually put the pieces first into a secondary warehouse or something like that, this is a good option to control which pieces are still on your shop and which pieces are in your secondary location or warehouse and which pieces went through your actual job site already. So that's created in a job-by-job basis. Now, if you need a route that actually will be used for more than one job, I will better create that on my global library. And you will find that one under maintenance, production control, and global shipping route maintenance. So every shipping route that you create in here will be available by default for any new job after the creation of the shipping route. And even if you want to use that shipping route for all jobs, the only extra step that you need to do is, for example, I will select these routes and go to my shipping route pull down, copy the selected to the jobs, and then this will show you all the jobs that don't have those shipping routes in them yet. So I'll just go ahead and include that into all my old jobs so that these three routes are available for them. Okay, so let's take a look. I have three routes in here. One is for galvanizers, and if I open the properties to show you, I actually create the destination called galvanizer, where I actually include all the firms that are coming from my address book that I commonly use for, galvanizing material. So I have ABC galvanizer, bottomless kettle, and EPM supplier. What I'm saying here is I will ship the material with this shipping route to any of these three destinations, and then from there, either the material will be coming back to my shop or I'll be going from there to the job site. So those two options are actually pick when you are creating the shipping ticket. I'll show you in a moment. That's the first route. I have also one more for galvanizing, but this is particular for parts. If you have some of these columns where you have one or two plates that are actually shipping loss to a galvanizer and then they come back for fit up, weld, and then shipping to the job site, I actually have this extra shipping route for them, gal parts, and I am actually joining with the assembly right after the galvanizer's destination. So when you ship the assembly, the weight for those plates or loose elements, it will be attached to the assembly already. And then I have a third one. This is something that I commonly have seen with some of the clients we have. If they have all kind of possibilities for subcontracting. You know, like they can send something to a rolling band, or I think I have some examples here. Let me just show my properties. I have this to a band supplier, right? If you need to bend some plates, I have this supplier right here. Or if I need to send something for powder coating, it can be in here too. If you have to ship something for a subcontractor to do some weld or some fabrication, it can be included in here too, or for rolling. So all those intermediate destinations, if you know, if you don't want to have a big library of intermediate shipping routes, you can create something general just like this intermediate shipping. I personally prefer to have, you know, a more well-structured database of shipping routes with the different process that I am subcontracting, but this is also an option that I wanted to present to you as a valuable. So anyway, let me close this and show you how this works. So I will go ahead and open the production control job, all of it, and we'll proceed to assign the shipping routes. Now, while this is loading, just have in mind that you can preset your shipping routes to a finish. So in your finish maintenance, if you want to your galvanizing route attached to your galvanized finish, you can set that. So every new import that you do after you save this, it will then identify any piece that has to be galvanized and assign that shipping route for you. All right. Now, in this case, this was actually imported before I changed that setting. So I'll go ahead and do a global edit to assign that to my assemblies. So I'll just go in global edit, finish, sorry about that, here it is, and just select the galvanized pieces, and then I'll just only do main pieces for now, which that takes care of the whole assembly, at least that you have the load tracking selected. Shipping route, it is the galvanizer route, okay, yes, and that's done. And then I know I have one of the columns here that actually has a loose plate that needs to be galvanized. Use the only thing you can see the column is paint, but this particular plate here, the M2, is galvanized. So I will assign the load tracking option for that plate only, and then I will be able to assign the gal parts route to that. Now, what this means is, okay, I need to ship some of those pieces. So if I go back to EPM to prove my point, and let me just go back to the main screen, shipping status, and go to the destinations actually, and reload the web page. And now I will have more than just the job site on the options here. You can see that now I have every single option where I can ship pieces to based on the shipping routes that I have in use in this job are showing up in here. So I will actually go and ship in some to the bottomless kettle supplier. I know there is nothing pre-planned in there, so I'll just go ahead and create a load. And I will say this is to be returned actually. And I will just go with the small trailer, the T01. I think it's a T02 is even smaller. Yep. Add load, confirm, material. And when I go to the add batch option, you know, in a normal situation, this will just show you any material that hasn't been shipped yet. In here, it will be showing you only the pieces that have to go to a galvanizer, right? You can see that I have the assemblies with the finish as galvanized, but I also have here in the bottom the M2 plate, which is the loose plate that I will ship. So just, I know this will be an empty truck, but just to prove my point, I will actually go and ship those plates to this guy. So update that, and then I'll just go ahead and go back and create my shipping process for this guy. And I will also go ahead and create one more, this time to an AVC galvanizer. I show on ship loads at, this will be my T03, and add load, confirm. And in this case, I will just go ahead and add some material too. As you may be aware of this, but you can see that every piece that you include into your load here is actually pre-setting the weight in here. So you can always compare that against your capacity and make sure that you are not over that capacity, right? So I'll just pick a couple of random pieces just because I want to show you how that looks into the actual current status screen. So I update that, and then I will go back to my load and do my shipping process. Confirm that. it needs done. And now you may see this already, but when you get the bill of lading, the difference, again, a normal bill of lading is that it will actually show the address of your galvanizing supply instead of the job site address that knows where that it's being sent to, and it will just go ahead and show your address for your galvanizer right here. All right, so I'll go back to EPM and let me show you something right here. If I go to the load tracking screen and you don't remember where the pieces were sent to, there is always the current locations option in here that will show you, hey, these pieces are with the ABC galvanizer, and they are supposed to then after go to the job site, right? This particular plate is with bottomless kettle, and then it should come back and go to the galvanizer. So that's the option right there. You will need to go and actually return that plate, because I said that plate will be returning to my shop. So when that happened, the only thing that I need to do is go there and say, hey, this piece right here is actually being returned. So I'll go ahead and return the six of six. If only three of them were sent back first, you can control that and say, yeah, only three have been returned, and that will be keeping track of those for you. That's very important. If you say something is returning to your shop, make sure that you return those pieces to your shop, because otherwise when you go and put those pieces or try to put those pieces into a load, they will not show up because they are still in your galvanizer instead of your actual shop. Last thing I want to show you here, it's just the how this looks in the model interface. Now, while Trimble Connect opens, just let me show you this real quick. If you go to the release information to the 16.1, you will find there a quick manual and a video about shipping enhancements and the shipping routes. That's the version where they were created. So you can check that material for more details or contact your help desk to know more about this. Anyway, so this is open. Let me share my screen. And then this one here. And the only thing that I wanted to show you here is that when you go to the colorize by option and you go to the shipping status, instead of the typical not completed or job site, this is actually showing you the location of your material, right? So this is showing you the pieces that are assigned to a load, but they haven't, you know, been shipped to the job site. The pieces that have been loaded to a job, right? So you can see even they are just assigned but not loaded, or they are already loaded. But you can also see which pieces are with ABC galvanizer and which pieces are with bottomless kettle or any other supplier that you will be using. This will be showing you all of them. So hopefully this helps you a little. As I said, if you need any help, please feel free to contact help desk in your area. And thank you for watching.